Welcome to the Organ Podcast from the Royal College of Organists with me, Mark O'Brien. In this episode, I'll be talking to the Chief Executive of the Royal College of Organists, Sir Andrew Parmley, about his plan for the College and his hopes for this year's International Organ Day, which will be on April the 20th.
All I'm trying to do is put the organ back into the British psyche and make people aware that it's there and it's a wonderful thing. It's not an anachronism.
I also meet David Pipe, organist of Huddersfield Town Hall, to hear about some of the imaginative musical collaborations he's been involved with.
Because there are a lot of people there, black t-shirts, braided beards, you know, it was not the typical Monday lunchtime organ recital crowd.
But first, it's the largest cathedral in Britain, and it houses the largest pipe organ in Britain. That must mean only one thing. I'm in Liverpool's Anglican Cathedral. But I'm not here because it's got the largest pipe organ in Britain. I'm here because the largest pipe organ in Britain is about to get even larger as part of the cathedral's centenary celebrations for 2024. Today, the organ firm of David Wells are winching up the final parts of a new echo division, which is going to live right up in a gallery at the end of the east roof section, which is right above the high altar. And as I'm walking up the nave here, I can see there are about eight or nine men, all in hard hats, holding on to cables that are descending from a scaffolding section that's built right up into that gallery, which must easily be about 120, 150 feet from the ground. And leading this team from David Wells is Adrian Griffiths. So Adrian, what are you about to do right now?
We are hoisting up the remainder of the echo organ parts. We've got some of the 8-foot bases, some of the swell box, some rack pillars, and all sorts of other little bits and pieces. We hoist them up in trays and in bags, and it takes a good 3 minutes for the electric winch just to lift everything up.
I mean, that's how high this project is. But working at this height, I'm assuming this is slightly out of the routine job for an organ builder.
It certainly is. I mean, most organs are pretty high. Everything in Liverpool Cathedral is bigger than anywhere else. So the height is an issue. But using a big scaffold tower and a winch like this is certainly unusual.
There aren't many organs with an echo division like this. I always thought that an echo division was quite a small instrument, but not so here.
Nothing small here. It's 10 or 11 stops, full soundboard, board on bass pipes. So it's a complete organ in its own right, really, because this is completely enclosed in a swell box with shutters. It is a mini swell.
Pedals?
Yeah, yes, the two pedal stops. But the whole thing about this organ was it was conceived to be a surround sound instrument with the main part of the organ here in the choir, but with a big echo organ, a big West End organ, a big central space organ, a big ethereal organ. There was organs everywhere. Because one of the big things about this cathedral is the liturgy uses the space. So the choir walks around lots of big services a year. They don't just sing from the stalls. And having organ pipes and sounds throughout the building means that you are supported wherever you are.
And there's a nice story about this particular echo section, isn't there, about where the pipes from this organ have come from?
Yes, they're Willis pipework.
Henry Willis III?
Yes, mm-hmm. made in the factory, made by the same people. We rescued an organ from St James Waterfoot a few years ago, and the pipework and the whole thing is contemporary with the main organ. They were made by the same people. We've already used some of the pipes in the central organ, and this pipework is that pipework. So it's part of the organ, really.
And have you had to change any of it? I mean, to fill this space, it's coming from a small church into the biggest cathedral in the UK. Have you had to increase the scalings of the pipe? Do you have bigger wind pressure? How does it fit?
No, it's all as it was, because that's part of the beauty of this being an echo organ. It's not meant to be a huge sound, but also the acoustics of the chamber where it is really help to throw the sound into the building. So it speaks as it did.
Well, can we go up and have a look? Is that
absolutely
is that possible? Probably not in the winch, but is there another way of
136 steps.
Right, come on.
Yes, we'll just pull the door over. That's the Lady Chapel.
We're going past, oh, I see
past
where
the
we
Lady
are.
Chapel open off the door.
We're sort of going inside one of the big columns of this cathedral, aren't we, in the spiral staircase.
And that's the blowing chamber for the Lady Chapel.
Gosh, so the blowers are above the organ.
Yes.
Oh, that's interesting. How many blowers altogether in this cathedral?
Oh, blimey. The main organ's got three. The central space has got one. The militaire's got one. There'll be one for the echo. There's one for the Lady Chapel. There's one for the Peter Collins practice organ. There's one for the Nigel Church organ. So I think there's, in total, there's nine blowers.
Nine blowers? I mean, presumably you need a special mini power plant for that.
You've certainly got to be careful when you turn the main organ blowers on. They're turned on in sequence with about 30 seconds delay between each one. Otherwise, the lights will dim if you turn them all on at once.
You take out most of Liverpool.
Yes.
Well, where are we now? We're in the roof of the cathedral. This is fun.
We're in the roof space of the Lady Chapel, yes.
Wow.
And this is about halfway in the stairs that we've got to climb.
Okay, off to you.
I need a bit more of a rest. Okay.
I mean, there's a very special sound, the organ here. It is unique. I mean, yes, it's big. But how do you sum up, really, the effect that organ has here?
That's a difficult one. I think it's two things. There's the voicing and the scaling of Henry Willis, which I think is second to none. But then there's the peculiar acoustics of the space that moulds the sound and throws it around. And for some people, there's too much echo, but I think most of the time it works, and that creates part of the sound.
Oh, you begin to feel it in the back of your legs now, don't you?
This is where it's going, this bay.
Wow, so we made it. We're at the top. And you realise how big it is. I mean, now we're in this chamber from when we were downstairs looking up at the bits of scaffolding poking out. I mean, this is... Well, it's a small church, really, isn't it?
It's huge. There are one, two, three... I think there are six bays. Each one, I don't know, 12 feet wide.
And nearly 30 foot, 25 foot high. Yeah. Then we go through into another chamber...
Yes, and in this bay we've got some soundboards and some pedal chests and shutter front. Then we come through to the next bay. We've got wind trunks, action.
Well, I can see most of the pipeworks up here already waiting for the formal build to begin. What are the actual stops you've got?
We've got a diapason chorus with a lovely sparkly mixture on the top, beautiful 8-foot Liebig-Gedeck flute, two smashing strings, a couple of reeds and some pedal stops.
And when's it going to be ready?
Well, good question.
You're the builder.
I know. How long's a piece of string? It shouldn't take that long to get it playing up here as we had it in the workshop, but it is going to take some time to integrate it with the existing control system and it being playing from the console.
Are you going to have to change the console? Because presumably you've got to put, 12 new stops... and a new swell pedal onto both consoles, the main console and the mobile console?
We've already made the changes, actually. We've had a rolling restoration of the organ over quite a few years, and when we overhauled the console, we prepared for this division. The swell pedals are very clever because there are three swell pedals and a general crescendo, but there are more than three boxes, and there are little dials, and you can assign each box to a pedal. So, again, it's already prepared for. There's a little switch that says echo, and you can have the echo on the first pedal or the swell on the first. You can have them all on the same pedal, but you've got complete flexibility in how you control the boxes.
I mean, that sounds great, but it also sounds impossibly complicated. I mean, when you've got visiting organists coming here, do they sort of have to go in for an induction video or be given this huge training manual?
Yes. It's not for the faint-hearted sitting down at the console. And it's one of the reasons why, for visiting choirs, staff organists are used, because it is a complicated instrument, especially for accompanying. It's not so bad if you're playing a recital, but when you've got to show some restraint and accompany, then that's a different matter.
Now, you look after the whole cathedral organ here. How, I mean, is it like the Fourth Bridge? How often do you have to tune this?
It is. We're normally in every other week.
Every other week?
Every other week.
Every two weeks, tune this organ?
Yes. Every 2 weeks, I mean, I can't tune the whole thing in a day. It takes me 6 whole days to tune the whole thing, which we do twice a year.
But that's more than other places. I mean, that regularity, surely, is that quite...
It is more than other places. It's not more than a lot of cathedrals where the quality of the music and the importance of the organ being bang in tune all the time. The building has its own little microclimate, and as the temperature changes, so the pitch changes because the speed of sound in air changes.
So a microclimate, I mean, really, we're talking its own weather system that affects the tuning of the organ?
Yes. And it can take 4 or 5 days for the temperature to change. So if it's been a very cold week, then it doesn't affect the inside of the building until 4, 5, 6 days later.
And presumably it's quite dangerous. I mean, we're right up here where we're installing the echo chamber, but of course, famously, this organ has a corona section. It's got the famous trumpet militaire right up at the top of the tower and on high-pressure wind. I mean, do you take your life into your own hands when you tune this?
Not really. We've done everything that we can to make it as safe as it can be. Yes, there are some dodgy corners, but you don't put yourself in a risk for anything. For this operation, for instance, I'm in a safety harness with a lanyard, so I'm clipped on. We wear ear protection. We've all got steel toe cap boots and all that sort of thing. So we try to look after ourselves when we can.
It's pretty exciting, really. This is not an average tuning job.
It's not an average tuning. It's not an average job at all. It's a fantastic job.
And in a few months' time, you're just going to have more to tune.
Yeah, there is that.
Adrian, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Well, the new Echo Division will be up and running in time for its dedication and inaugural recital given by the cathedral organist Ian Tracy on Saturday, the 19th of October. And before that, I'll be going back to Liverpool Cathedral to meet Ian Tracy at the console to hopefully get a sneak preview of the new Echo and to hear how it fits in with the rest of the organ. Now, here's something completely different. This is organic doom metal, which is kind of similar to heavy metal, but a bit slower. And the reason you're listening to this is because hopefully you can hear the organ of Huddersfield Town Hall being played by David Pipe. Now, this happened last year as part of the Kirklees Year of Music, but it's beginning to catch on with other performances in Huddersfield this month and events at St Mary Redcliffe in Bristol and Rochester Cathedral in Kent in the planning. Now, this is a great example of the type of imaginative collaborations that David Pipe gets involved with in his drive to bring the organ to new audiences. David, who's held posts at York Minster and Leeds Cathedral, is the organist at Huddersfield Town Hall and the artistic director of the Leeds International Organ Festival. I spoke to David about his passion for getting the organ to do things that are perhaps a bit unexpected, and I began by asking him how he got involved in doom metal in the first place.
I was chatting to Mark Minett, who's a senior lecturer at the University of Huddersfield in music technology. as conversations progressed, Mark said, well, I've got this friend who is in an atmospheric doom metal band. And actually, it turned out later in the day that West Yorkshire, Huddersfield area is the so-called cradle of this kind of music. So lots of stars aligned really for this. And we did the gig and we got so much interest. I didn't expect. I was interviewed on, I think, German radio. I was interviewed. We were on Radio 4. We've been recently on local TV Look North. Visually, it looked impressive. The organ at the back, and they got the smoke going, and they got all these, you know, flashing lights. It looked like to my mind, a metal gig would do. But at the back of it, there was this great big pipe organ.
And you do this in Huddersfield Town Hall?
Yeah, well, we got, 300 people, which isn't a huge number, but I think it was a Monday night in Huddersfield. No one was really expecting triple figures, to be fair.
Well, I suspect a different-looking audience.
Very different. But I was so pleased about that, because there are a lot of people there, black T-shirts, braided beards. You know, it was not the typical Monday lunchtime organ recital crowd. And that was actually my biggest sense of pride and achievement. The music was great too. It was fun to do. But the fact we'd attracted a very different audience in. There was one person actually who was a regular subscriber to the Monday series. Also some children there. So it was a really good cross-section.
A lot of this can get interest because of the sheer novelty factor of it. But are you thinking there might be legacy from this collaboration?
That's a great word. I hope so. And I think in Huddersfield, we've talked about legacy a lot. The Year of Music had a certain amount of funding behind it. And that takes the edge off. When you know there's money to do something, we got the hall free for that. And that was a very generous, but also wonderful bonus. I don't think we could have done it without the hall for free. And they're saying, well, look, this has brought in a different audience. It's brought in international interest, not just local. Yes, our legacy is we should try and do this again, because actually there are a lot of people who said, I would never have thought about coming to this kind of gig at that kind of venue, and I loved it. When's the next one? So I think legacy is the word. I mean, a lot of the news has said, is this the saviour of these churches that are closing down? I think that's, to my mind, a leap far too far. But if you've got a church that has an organ that hasn't been used, it's a big enough church and all the factors are correct, yes, why not do it? If the powers that be are happy, get the organ used, bring a band in, you know, with a bit of creative lighting, it can look amazing.
Do you find that always having to think that you're saving something from the church is holding you back and limiting your imagination? Because it's not about necessarily saving something from the church, but by utilising a currently living instrument.
I think it would be wrong to detach too much. I mean, this particular programme we're talking about, Atmospheric Doom, would all churches welcome that with open arms? I don't think there's anything heretical in it. In fact, one of the things was all about St. Cuthbert. So there is actually a religious element in that, if you look at it that way. And there's a thrill of playing organ music with an amazing acoustic behind you. You're playing the building more too, and that's a thrill. Probably the best organs in the country are still going to be in cathedrals. Yes, there are some wonderful concert hall examples, but I think it would be a mistake to try and separate organs in churches and cathedrals and organs elsewhere. I think the two must meet. Players certainly will be playing on both types. So I think it's very important we do embrace all of them.
And another string to your bow is that you set up the International Organ Festival in Leeds.
Yeah, Leeds Cathedral. So there's been an organ recital series going before I arrived, but we thought we'd make something a bit more of it. So we've called it the International Organ Festival. And that has also meant, obviously, we've had players from abroad. So for me, the word festival in there meant it has to have something else. My aim, again, I mean, everything I do, is to try and make the organ slightly different from what people may have come across before. Yes, we have to have the, in inverted commas, standard type of recitals. But I think it's very important that people are made to realise it can do other things too. We had a jazz concert a few years ago. I teamed up with a friend who plays with Van Morrison, a percussionist. In that same festival, we had a little concert of Baroque cantatas for tenor, flute and strings. So I think variety is the key in these kind of things. But we've enjoyed it.
And does where you are inform that? Because you're in Leeds, we're in Yorkshire here, it's quite a diverse industrial area. We've got Bradford round the corner, there's Huddersfield. We're not far from Manchester. Is in this Yorkshire region, is there a fertile ground for going beyond the traditional then with the organ?
I think it's just trying to make people realise the rich availability of instruments. You know, in Leeds itself, there's the cathedral Kleist restoration of a Norman Beard instrument. You've got that wonderful Schultz out at Armley, where Graham Barbara looks after things. You've got the Town Hall. We're you know, bated breath to see what the Town Hall organ is going to be like soon. That should be amazing. And obviously Leeds Minster, obviously known as formerly known as Leeds Parish Church, with that wonderful Harrison instrument. And they're all quite different organs. You know, they've each got their character. So I think we're lucky in this city alone. And then, you know, we've mentioned Huddersfield at length. That's not very far away. Manchester, you keep going on the train line, assume you can get there, and you've got all the wealth of things there too. So I think it is a rich ground, actually. I think there are a lot of opportunities. There are all these places where you can hear organ music quite regularly, and I think we just need to make people aware of that.
And are you excited? I mean, are you optimistic that what you're doing is making some sort of success?
Yes, I say that partly with one recent memory in mind, a primary school's organ day in Huddersfield. One of the workshops in the morning was this thing called Woof It, which you may have come across. It's a man called Jeremy Sampson, who's a violinist from Warwick. And it stands for the Wooden One-Octave Organ for Young Technologists. It's really a chromatic one-octave organ made out of bits of wood and plumbing pieces. And the kids operate quite primitive bellows, so they pump away. And then another little group have a board over the reservoir to keep the pressure going. There's a pressure gauge. And then each child is assigned a note to play, and they do things like Twinkle Twinkle Little Star, Happy Birthday. And when we've done this together, I've been at the big organ, and Jeremy has said, well, here's a little pipe from the Woof It, I'll play it. This is what we might call a flue, or possibly a diapason, a principal. David, what does it sound like on the big organ? And I'll play a little bit, and then we'll talk about reeds and all kinds of different sounds we can make. My favourite thing was where we start the music in the concert after Jeremy had done his talk about Woof It and how that worked. All the lights went down and suddenly the smoke machine was going. And I played Bach Toccata in D minor. And because all of these lights were doing their thing like at a rock concert, the kids were entranced. And I'm convinced that if children hear a good organ, hopefully played well and do my best, they'll be interested. And I think it's like anything. If you don't throw a child a football, he or she will not know that you have potential to kick it. And you might be kicking it really, really well. And the next thing you know, you're a multinational player. But I think the real success, if I may say, of this is you can tick curriculum boxes here. You know, there's science involved, technology. Clearly, there's music involved. This is what an organ does. This is how it works. You know, you three, come here. You're in charge of the bellows. You two, you're in charge of the reservoir. You can come and play some notes and they swap round. And it's literally hands-on. And I think it's very, very good. And I'd love for us to go and do it in other places, because I think there'd be so many. You know, it could be a church, it could be a town hall, it doesn't really matter. There are so many places where I think children would really benefit from hearing that. And it's an enjoyable thing. It's got to be enjoyable, hasn't it? So another thing I've done, which is a little bit unexpected, is I was approached recently by an alumnus of Huddersfield University who now works for RuneScape, which is an online game. And I'm not a gamer at all, so it's all slightly out of my knowledge area. But he was keen to have an organ, a live pipe organ, recorded, because one of these scenes, the battle ends around an organ. And I recorded quite a lot of arpeggios, and so I'm on RuneScape's Necromancy. I'm not a gamer, so I doubt I'll ever actually get to hear this in context. But it does sound pretty cool, and again, how many people know that an organ could be used in video game music? So it's a minor claim to fame for me, but it's nice, I think, that so many people are there. And of course, it proves that the organ really is the world's oldest and biggest synthesizer.
And you could be the world's most listened to organist if it's on a popular game.
We never know. You never know.
Millions listening.
Possibly.
To you.
I spoke to a pupil who's into computers in a big, big way, and I said, I've played on this. And his eyes lit up. He couldn't believe it. Yeah, they really, really went to town. It was the organ where the RCO does its exams in Huddersfield, St Paul's Hall at the university, which actually sounds really good for this. It's got quite an edge to it, that organ. So it was a lot of fun.
So who knows? A load of new organists coming from the gaming industry.
We might do. It was a good thing to do.
Sir Andrew Parmley is the chief executive of the Royal College of Organists, a post he's held since 2018 in an extraordinary life that's been dedicated to music, education, charity, and civic engagement. But his passion for the organ has always remained with him from a young boy growing up in Blackpool to becoming the 689th Lord Mayor of the City of London. I met Sir Andrew at his home in Blackpool to talk about his musical background and the work he's doing in leading the RCO. So I guess you are a proud Lancastrian. You were born in Manchester and you grew up where we are now. We're in Blackpool. This is your hometown. And this is really, I guess, where perhaps your love affair with the organ started.
Well, it was indeed. I mean, I didn't mean to play the organ. I didn't mean to play anything. I'm the youngest of three boys. When the oldest was born, my mother bought a piano. He wouldn't play it. The second one would only play football. I didn't get a choice, and I was forced to sit at the piano and diddle away on the keys in a lacklustre manner. The curious story is that in those far-off days, meat used to be delivered by a boy with a basket on the front of a bicycle.
The butcher delivery boy.
The butcher's delivery boy, open all hours, etc. And one particular Saturday morning, this lad arrived, and the window was open. I was tinkling the piano, and he said to my mother, "That boy should learn to play properly." And I said, "Go away, please," or words to this effect. But when I went to big school, this same chap was the head boy. And he said, "Come here, Parmley, I'm going to show you how the school organ works." And frankly, I didn't know you could make that much noise on your own. So I was hooked from that moment onwards.
So your musical career, a lot of it is owed to the butcher's delivery boy.
It is. A boy that is now a grand old man living in China and working for Chinese news agencies as an arts editor. So I owe him a lot. But I also owe my organ teacher in Blackpool a great deal. A man of great character, a Yorkshireman, despite that, a great, great teacher.
Well, they must have seen something in you, because at the age of 16, you got your ARCO and you did your FRCO 2 years later. So you were obviously going places with the organ.
The teacher that I mentioned was a bit of a tyrant. And so when we decided we're doing the ARCO, we are doing the ARCO. A couple of years later, I would say it was the summer of 76 when there was a heat wave and there's no possibility of sleep. So I used to spend the night sitting up, practicing transposition, score reading, etc. And all those difficult tests that we have to do for FRCO. No heat wave, no FRCO, in my opinion.
Now, that's an odd excuse for getting that sort of skill to do that. But I guess, in a way, your first sort of major association with the Royal College of Organists was the result of a scholarship.
Well, indeed. I was in the upper six and read the Musical Times, and there was a small advert. It said, scholarships offered by the Royal College of Organists tenable either at the Royal College of Music or the Royal Academy of Music. Come to London on such a date and play the Bach A minor fugue. And it happened that I could play the Bach A minor fugue, so I went to London and indeed got myself a scholarship called the William Robert Shaw Exhibition, tenable at the Royal Academy of Music. I was then summoned by the management of the Academy to an interview because they weren't just going to let me in. So I took the train from Blackpool and I walked up the Euston Road to the Royal Academy, and a grand old man played a chord on the piano and said to me, "Is that major or minor?" And I answered. He never said whether I was right or wrong. And he said, "That'll do. Thank you. You can go now." So I went back to Blackpool. That was my interview at the Academy. I think things are very different now. The Academy is a very, very serious place.
Sarah. Yeah. And what were you thinking of doing then? Were you wanting to be a cathedral organist? I mean, where were you heading?
No. After the Academy, I went back to Blackpool, and my love had always been theatre, and I'd hoped to move into the West End eventually. But my first paid employment was at the Blackpool Pleasure Beach, where I became director of music to the world's biggest fairground. My first duty at the Pleasure Beach was to play at the ice show. And my first client there was Mary Chipperfield, and my job was to play for ice skating chimpanzees.
So you went from the Royal Academy of Music into the circus, musical theatre, essentially. That's an odd move, isn't it?
Well, I think John Major ran away from being an accountant to join the circus. Or was it the other way around?
I don't know. And so musical theatre then was, I mean, were you wanting to be a budding Andrew Lloyd Webber or a
No, not a composer, but an MD. And after a lot of trying, I found myself MDing the national tour of Godspell, which went very well for a while. Then one day, Margaret Thatcher declared yet another general election, theatres closed, and I was out of work. And I went home and said to Wendy, I've lost my job. And she said, now you're going to do something serious. Go and train yourself up as a teacher. And I moved into the role of director of music in several independent schools, which I thoroughly enjoyed.
But if we fast forward slightly, the organ was always there for you, because is it fair enough to say that through getting a job of playing an organ in London in St. James Garlickhithe, in a roundabout way, that actually led you on the path to be Lord Mayor of London?
Absolutely the case. The story is rather bizarre, but in February 1982, the organist, I dare mention his name, he's a well-known personality, Simon Lowell, asked me to play for one service, and he never came back. So over 40 years later, I'm still playing the organ. And indeed, 40 years on, I'm still waiting to be paid, because after that first service, the vicar said, what do we owe you? I said, don't worry about that, I'll see Simon. Well, four decades later, I've not seen Simon. So if you're listening, Simon, I'm looking for you.
I know him. He might be quitting. But how did that happen? I mean, how was the leap for being the organist in that church that then got you into, you know, we're talking the guilds, we're talking, you know, the medieval offices of the City of London?
Yeah, the highest offices one can achieve without being born into the aristocracy, to be honest. I mean, it's again a very simple story. One of the church wardens came with me for dinner in Cambridge, and driving back down the M11 after dinner, I was driving him home, and he said, had I ever considered joining the Common Council? I said, I have no idea what the Common Council is, which is the oldest continuous municipal authority in the world, running the square mile. So I stood for election and indeed got myself a seat as a councillor. I became chairman of the Guildhall School of Music and Drama, chairman of the girls' school, City of London School for Girls. I joined the Court of Aldermen, worked hard, did my after-dinner speaking, worked for charity, worked with church, worked with the military. Particularly, I worked very hard to get a working knowledge of financial services. And in due course became sheriff and then got the greatest unpaid job in the world. I was Lord Mayor for a year in 2016-17, travelled the globe, 100 days abroad, 30 countries, 250 interviews, beautiful, and living in Mansion House, what a joy.
After being Lord Mayor, you became the chief executive of the Royal College of Organists. When you got that, what do you think you inherited, and did you immediately have a plan of something you thought you needed to do?
Well, my memory of the RCO was as it was in the 70s, the building in Kensington Gore, etc. Frosty old men sitting around a table discussing chants for psalms and all that sort of stuff. I mean, founded in 1864. What I actually inherited was a well-established, beautifully run, very small charity with a fantastic staff working very, very hard. I mean, people may not know that there are no full-time members of staff for the RCO. Everyone's part-time. There are no premises, so we work virtually. We meet regularly by Zoom. I also inherited an old-fashioned belief that the RCO was elitist, that it was about cathedrals and public schools and about Oxbridge and not about every organist. So one of my passions has been to take the organ to a much wider public. We've been doing that in a number of ways. First of all, with declining church attendance, fewer children are hearing the organ, unless they are happen to be at a private school or at involved with a cathedral in some way. So children don't hear the organ, don't think, I'd like to have a go at that, don't take it up. So one of my programmes is to put digital organs into maintained sector schools. This isn't cheap, but we have a relationship with Viscount Classical Organs, and between Viscount and the Royal College of Organists in the last 2 years, we've placed nearly 36 instruments in schools up and down the country. And I'm about to go to Aberdeenshire to speak to the Scottish Federation of Organists to see if we can get some organs into Scotland, and I've still to get some into Wales. So if you're listening in either Scotland or Wales, would like a two-manual and pedal Viscount, please get in touch. We're now very close to the American Guild of Organists, and this summer, six RCO representatives will be attending the San Francisco Convention to talk to Americans and try and get closer to them. We're also very close to the Royal Canadian College of Organists. Now, sometimes people say, well, it's only about examinations. frankly, not the case at all. It's about a wide range of other things. Courses for young people. It's about our website, which is phenomenal. If you've not looked at IRCO, please look at it. An enormous wealth of materials. And we're developing all the time. Some new initiatives on the horizon, working with organ organisations, organ builders, church authorities, church advisors about organs, all sorts of people. We are building a new website called First Stop, which will be the starting point for any question anybody may have about the organ. And in terms of initiatives into the future, we're working on Play the Organ Year 25, when we invite any number of people to play the organ.
Now, there's a lot going on here. Now, I assume a lot of this is your initiative, your passion, that when you took over the RCO. In a sense, are you changing the direction?
I'd like to think that I am. But I'm not throwing the baby out with the bathwater. I fully acknowledge that the majority of our membership are engaged in church activities. However, we're not a religious organisation. We're not the Royal School of Church Music. We're about organists. So I'm trying to secularise the instrument where I can.
But is that going to work? Because there is the physical reality of where it's situated.
There's a resurgence of interest in the town hall instrument and up and down the country. As you know from the Calais Call in Manchester, councils are getting round to restoring their great instruments. The resurgence there's a great interest in the home organ at present.
So we're talking digital, Hauberk, or a digital.
Or Allen, whatever it might be.
Yeah.
And during lockdown, sales rose quite dramatically for domestic arrangements. I'm also interested in the organ in the Masonic Temple and how we can assist Masons to play better. And of course, seeing as we are sitting in Blackpool, I'm very interested in the cinema organ all over the world. And we have one of the finest in the world, not far from where we're sitting.
Now, this is a departure then from what you were saying might be the original perceptions of the RCO. Opening your doors to that extent, have you encountered opposition?
There's always a group who will say there's only one sort of organ. It has to have a big row of pipes and a big engine blowing wind through them. And you are, of course, right. But the digital organ is a very good substitute. And it amazes me how many people that criticise the programme of putting digital organs into school, how many of those people actually play pipe organs, but secretly have got a digital organ at home for practice purposes. They're not the real thing, but they're a very, very good substitute. And actually, as we discovered in Westminster Cathedral in 2019, when we installed 7 Viscounts to go alongside the 2 pipe organs, put them in the right acoustic with the right speakers, and many people would be hard put to tell the difference between a digital organ and the real thing.
In your role of expanding the RCO into new territories, who is it you're trying to reach outside then of that traditional cathedral format? What would they be able to do, either for a job or musically, with the organ?
Well, it's very few organists actually are professional in that respect. I mean, the cathedral people and the Oxbridge colleges and a very small number of internationally known recitalists. But as with most instruments that are learnt at school, violin, flute, etc., people don't go on to play in orchestras, but they develop a love of the instrument and of its repertoire. And all I'm trying to do is bring the organ back into the centre of public life. Where we're sitting, when I was a boy, there were at least 10 robed choirs with really expert organists playing very fine pipe organs. The organist in those days was also the local music teacher, taught privately, ran the choral society. But basically, the organ was front and centre in local life. And as we've seen in recent years with the passing of our late Queen and the coronation of the King, the organ is also crucial to national life. Moments of great celebration or mourning, the organ is the key instrument. So all I'm trying to do is put the organ back into the British psyche and make people aware that it's there and it's a wonderful thing. It's not an anachronism.
Are you hands-on as chief executive? I mean, who runs the RCO?
We are non-hierarchical. So there are myself and 4 directors, each looking after a region. And when we have meetings, there isn't a boss. Everyone's view is equal.
And there are a lot of organisations really around the organ. I mean, it's the IAO, the Incorporated Association of Organists. Mm-hmm. And with that, there are a lot of very enthusiastic, very passionate local regional organists associations. And then, of course, you have the Royal School of Church Music, the RSCM. Where do you fit into that? Do you talk to each other?
We're all very good friends, as it happens. I work very closely with Hugh Morris at the Royal School of Church Music. I'm seeing Jonathan MacDonald from the Cathedral Music Trust soon. My next chairman at the Royal College of Organists is also the chairman of the Cathedral Organist Association. I have quarterly Zoom meetings with my oppos in Canada and New York, and we're very friendly. And my view is this, that these organisations are all here to help interested parties. We're not fighting for market share. We are all sharing. We're all trying to achieve the same end, which is to provide a service to help organists across this country and across the world play the organ better, enjoy it more, introduce more children and more public to it.
Well, one of the things that you have done to introduce more people to the organ was to create International Organ Day, which this year is on Saturday, the 20th of April. What was the thinking behind that?
Well, we started International Organ Day a long time ago as a way of introducing people to the organ and finding a focal point. So why not have it on a particular day in the year? And the original plan was that any building in the country that housed an organ would open its door. Church, cathedral, chapel, Masonic temple, cinema, whatever it was, town hall. And put a big sign outside, and we designed the posters saying, come in and have a go. And the plan was, bring kids in, there'd be some experts sitting on the bench, let you have a go for 20 minutes, see if you got a taste for the instrument. COVID came, and this never really happened. And in fact, unbeknown to us, across the world, not just across Great Britain, people did stage events, online performances, and then they posted the outcomes of what their activities on our website, and turned out there were a huge number of things going on across the world.
And what are the highlights you got then for this year's International Organ Day?
Well, first of all, go to the Royal College of Organists website and have a good look at what's being posted already. And in your local town, there is bound to be something going on. So if you are interested in the organ, even if you're not, perhaps you might be after you've visited. So go and find a building that's opening its doors and putting on a concert. There will be events across Canada, across Europe, and across the United States of America where people will celebrate International Organ Day and then post what they're doing on our website. There's bound to be something happening near you.
Sir Andrew Parmley, thank you very much indeed.
My privilege. Thank you.
Well, that's it for now. But don't forget International Organ Day on April the 20th. And in the next episode, I'll be at the Royal Birmingham Conservatoire talking to the head of organ, Daniel Moult, about some of the new organs he's commissioned there and his approach to equipping young organists with the skills they need for today. I also meet David Briggs. I'll be talking to David about his transcriptions, improvising, and his role at St. John the Divine in New York. So until then, from me, Mark O'Brien, goodbye.